Yeah, we talked about elliptic curves and how we can use them as a sort of drop-in replacement for the mathematics in things like Diffie-Hellman key exchange and the digital signature algorithm and so on. There's another interesting story that people are asking me to talk about, which is the story of the dual EC DRBG, or the dual elliptic curve deterministic random bit generator, right? Which is a pseudo-random generator for generating random numbers. Most of the time you do programming, you don't need something that's truly random. Right. If you're writing a computer game and you need the AI to act in a kind of unpredictable way, a normal, general mathematical random number generator that just moves some bits around and produces numbers between a minimum and a maximum should be fine. Right. For cryptography, that is not the case. For cryptography, what you need to not be able to do is predict anything to do with what it's going to output. It needs to be as random as you can. And of course, the problem with computers is they aren't random. They don't operate in a random way. So if I produce any mathematical function or any logic circuit that produces something that looks random, the problem is it isn't actually random. What a normal operating system will do is combine an actual source of randomness. So for example, the decay of a radioactive isotope, or my mouse clicks, which are kind of random, or my typing, which is sort of the pace of which is a bit odd. And it'll combine that actual randomness with something that produces a very long stream of random bits for use by applications on the machine. Right? These are called cryptographic random number generators. We're not talking about the actual randomness today. We're talking about the generators that generate these random bits. But they're used all the time. If you go on to, if you perform a handshake on the internet, you're going to be generating a random number used once, you're going to be generating the private part of a Diffie-Hellman key exchange, and so on. Right? So these need to be unpredictable. If I can predict your private Diffie-Hellman key, then I can just get straight in on your conversation. That's not a good thing. The way normally a random number generator like this works is a bit like this. So we have some kind of state, which we'll call S, and that's the current internals for our random number generator, and that is a secret. Now this is seeded based on real random data. So for example, the keyboard taps or the hard disk latency and things like this on a computer. Now what we do, I ask this random number generator to generate some random bits for me, and it passes this state through a function g, which is a one-way function like a hash function, and this produces some seemingly random bits which I can use in my application for something secure. Now if I ask it to produce g of s again, it's going to be the same thing. The hash is always the same. So what happens is at this point we pass s through another function f of s, right, and it comes back down here to be s plus 1. And so the state gets updated. This is in general what a random number generator will do. So we seed the random number generator with something actually random, and we keep doing that whenever we can, but it doesn't happen all the time. And then we can update the state, and we can generate random bits as required. Now, usually these are different functions, but often hash functions are what we use. The reason is because it has to be one way. What we absolutely want to make sure is that I can't work out as an attacker what this state is. Because if I can, I can predict the next random value you're going to be. That could be your password that you're generating on your password manager. So I've seen this output. This is something you sent into clear, let's say a random number or something. I've seen it. Can I calculate what the state is? Well, no, because to do that, I have to reverse this one-way function, this hash function. So I can't do it. I'm stuck here. That's the idea. Now, in the early 2000s, the National Institute for Standards and Technologies in the US published a list of four new random number generators. The idea being that these would be adopted by the kind of key players who are actually building these libraries, like OpenSSL. So most of these were the kind of standard, like I'm showing you here. One of them was based on elliptic curves and was a little bit unusual, and so it kind of piqued everyone's interest, and dare I say, piqued everyone's suspicion at the time. This was called the dual elliptic curve DRBG, which I'm just going to call dual EC from now on, otherwise I'm going to get very tongue-tied. It works very much like this using elliptic curves. Just to remind you, when we talked about elliptic curves, an elliptic curve looks a bit like this, and it has a formula of the type y squared is x cubed plus ax plus b. The idea is that this can be used to perform a one-way function like our hash. If we have a point here, p, on our curve, we can produce a multiple of p, let's say here, which is ap, and if I give you that, you can't tell me what a was. Right? That would be solving the elliptic curve discrete log problem. Very, very difficult. That's all we really need to know about the mathematics for this particular one. So we could replace these two one-way functions with these elliptic curve functions, this point addition, and kind of get the same kind of structure going. And the nice thing about it, if it worked, would be that this is kind of mathematically provable in some sense, because we know how difficult this problem is. We don't know for sure what the difficulty of this hash function is, because no one's broken it yet. Right? We all thought SHA-1 was unbreakable, and then what happened? All right. So how does dual EC work? All right, so we have our two random variables on our curve, right? P and Q. It doesn't matter where they are for this example. They're just points on the curve. So those each have an X and a Y coordinate. We have a state for our random number generator, S. That is not a point on the curve, it's just a number. So what we do, we want to use S to generate some random bits, but then we also need to update the state. And their state has to remain secret, remember. So the first thing we do is we calculate S P. Right, so we're moving P around the curve S times, right? And that gives us R. R is just the X coordinate of this. So this is going to be a point on the curve. We take the X coordinate and that's our number. Now, R is sort of an intermediate variable. We're going to use it to generate our random bits. So we calculate RQ and we take the X value, so RQ dot X in some sense, and we scrap the first 16 bits of that. We take the least significant bits of that from 16 to the end. I'm using sort of Python notation. Why not, right?
What sort of size in bits is that number?
They're going to be approximately 256 bits because they're modulo a prime that's 256 bits on this particular curve. Now, this is then our random number, right? So far, so good. We've got some random bits out. We then use R, we pass it through P again. So we say RP, doesn't matter why, and that produces our new S by taking just the X again. So what we've got is the exact same framework that I showed you at the beginning. We've got a state, we update the state by moving it around the elliptic curve a bit and taking just the X coordinate, but we also can output some bits. In principle, this is not a terrible idea for a random number generator, except that actually this is much slower than a normal hash-based one, by about 1,000 times, right? Which, for someone who really cares about security, maybe they would be able to accept that. But in fact, actually, there are some other bigger problems with this that mean that 1,000 times is really the good part of the deal, in some sense. Remember that the whole point of this is that if I get this in the clear, I can't reverse to find this internal state. The reason I can't do that is because, first of all, I don't know what RQ was, and even if I did, I can't go backwards through this to find R and then go this way. Right? So we can't reverse that because that is a one-way function. Remember, just because of the elliptic curve problem. If I was an attacker, how might I attack this? Well, the first thing is to notice is that 16 bits is not actually very many. So I can brute force through the possible RQs quite quickly. It's 2 to the 16 operations, 65,000 operations. Even on a laptop, not going to take very long. So I go through and I find all the possible Xs for this random data. And only some of them are going to adhere properly to that elliptic curve formula where we can find an actual Y that goes with them. Right? So let's say we go from 65,000 to 10. We have 10 candidates. That's a real problem. So we found that RQ. That alone wouldn't actually be much of a problem. So then the question becomes, can we reverse this discrete log problem and find our way into this state, which will be a huge issue? And the answer is, if these two are random, no, we can't do that. Right. If P and Q are truly random, we have to brute force it. We have to start with R is 1, doesn't work. R is 2, doesn't work.
And how many of those are there?
256 bits worth, which is...
lots.
Yeah. Gets a bit more complicated than that. Not all points are valid on the curve and so on, but there's a lot of them. Now, what if there was a secret mathematical relationship between P and Q? Would that change anything? What if P was actually equal to some multiple of Q, like this? Now, it would be very difficult to prove that because we can't solve that problem. We'd have to find that E by brute force and go, oh, there is a relationship between the two. Brilliant, right? We don't know. But the problem was that when the NIST standard came out, it was implied that the NSA were the ones that generated these points and they did not explain how they did it. Remember the video on nothing up my sleeve numbers? Let's pick a number at random, I don't know, 24, and then did some trick with it. You'd think, well, that's great, but clearly 24 wasn't random. There's something up the sleeve, we're not sure about it. If this is true, if there's a secret E, which we can multiply by Q to get to P, then here's what happens. We have RQ, because we've derived it from this here, right? We can calculate E, our secret E times RQ. It's associative, so it's actually R times EQ. EQ is P, so we've got R of P, which is this. And we've calculated the internal state. Right. This should be impossible to go backwards from here to get to here. It's trivial if we know this secret E, right? Which is kind of worrying. What's more interesting about this is not so much the mathematical backdoor that could exist, it's whether it exists, no one knows, and what happened when this NIST standard was announced. So when it was announced, cryptographers said, well, first of all, this is not enough bits you're cutting off here, right? There's a slight bias in the output, we don't like it, it doesn't look random enough, that's a problem. It's 1,000 times slower, that's a problem, right? NIST didn't worry too much about this. They said, it's fine, right, we're gonna put it in. Then in 2007, Dan Shumo and Niels Ferguson from Microsoft did a short talk explaining that this backdoor could exist. You know, that should have killed this off straight away. But the problem was that it was an agreed standard in NIST, it was starting to be implemented in some of these libraries, and that's deeply concerning. We don't know whether this exists. Hypothetically, it could, right? But no one can find this E, so how can we know? But then the Snowden leaks came along, and it looks even more suspicious. Money was changing hands between the NSA and companies to have them install this as their standard for number generation. That's deeply suspicious. And so the strong opinion, the consensus of the cryptographic community is that this is indeed a backdoor. Someone knows that E, but it isn't me. And but we don't know for sure. But it's a really interesting issue because there could be a backdoor, but there might not. Now, of course, when you're using this, you can generate your own P and Q, and then it hasn't got a backdoor. Well, unless you put it in yourself. But the interesting thing was in the NIST standard, they said you have to use this P and Q. If you don't, we won't give you a FIPS accreditation for being extra secure, which is also suspicious. So it's a really interesting read. If you read the history of this, people were coming up with problems, they were publishing papers saying that's not right, and they were being ignored, and the standard was put through anyway, which is, you know, very interesting. If I was on stage, I don't do magic, right? But if I was on stage and I said to you, let's pick a number at random, I don't know, 24, and then did some trick with it, you'd think, well, that's great, but clearly 24 wasn't random.
Mathematics to do with lines and the tangent of this curve. It's actually not very complicated. The point is that what we're doing is by multiplying G by various numbers or adding it to itself, this point addition, we're moving around this curve.